In this video, we will discuss the compatibility or non-compatibility of the Petterdale Terrier, also known as the Black Fell Terrier, one I have here on the leash, and cats. So, this is a Black Fell Terrier, also known as the Petterdale Terrier, the short-coated variety, and cats are also pets that are often kept by humans. And nowadays, a lot of people think that Petterdale is just a house dog because they are quite easy. Once exercised, it can be quite easy for a hunting terrier to be kept. This does not mean that they are the best choice for every situation. First, starting off with cats. Cats are predators and very good at it. Even your household cat is quite capable of killing rodents and also mouse, and very often also when they get in a fight with a dog, can hold their own quite well, because also the dog doesn't like to get hurt and the cat will bring the hurt because it has claws, it has a good bite, and they are willing to use that on a ferocious in a ferocious manner, and thereby they are often capable of keeping dogs off them, even those dogs that are a lot bigger than them. That being said, if you look at dogs that are also kept feral, so they were once household dogs and then they went the feral way, and like some cats are also still surviving, those feral dogs will very often kill feral cats. And it's quite known that dogs are able to kill cats, especially if they have big prey drive. So the bigger the dog they are, is the easier they will just ragdoll the cat, of course. And then you might say, yeah, Petterdale is quite a small type of dog, so it won't do that much damage. But you could be very wrong. And why is that? Hunting terriers are very often being bred to deal with other predators, especially foxes, but also oftentimes badgers and the like. In the United States, they're also dealing with raccoons, which are also kind of predator. All these animals, badgers, raccoons and foxes, are able to kill cats, and they also do that if they have the possibility to do so. So that could tell you something, and very often a Petterdale Terrier will destroy a fox or a raccoon and will put up a good fight with a badger, sometimes even killing it, but the other way around happens at least as many times. So that gives you some introduction. And all the terrier type of dogs that are being kept for performance will have a high prey drive. Other examples will be Malinois and working type shepherds, but also border collie and the likes. But the difference between a Petterdale Terrier and more of a collie herding dog, even those that are bred for protection work, they do not like to get hurt as much as a Petterdale does. So don't get me wrong, Petterdale Terrier is not a sadomasochistic type of animal. No, it isn't. But it will keep on the job till it's done and will not get scared off. So for example, if it faces off with a fox or a badger, the damage it receives is a lot more than that of a cat, and still it will be on it. And that cat, if they would engage, they could be in big trouble. So if you're still in there and really want to keep Petterdales and cats together, which I normally would not recommend, but if you're thinking this through and you really want to, of course a lot can be done. And there are a few pointers. One is get the dog at a young age so it can be accustomed to the cat and also know its boundaries a little bit more. That's the first point. Second point, very important, is never let them be alone together. So for example, if you go away, keep the cat in one room and the dog in the other, and make sure that they normally cannot interact. Third, if you get a cat, better get a cat that is quite capable of defending itself and also a little bit bigger. So what do I mean? You have very big cats like Maine Coon, Norwegian forest cat, and ragdoll that will sustain a lot less relative damage with a fight with a terrier, for example, Pretzel terrier. The other thing is they can hold it off a lot longer because they are a lot stronger. Fourth thing, if you go this route, try to give the cat some more escape possibilities. And keep in mind, if you have a cat entering or leaving the facility, very oftentimes a terrier can just follow it there. But it will be a little bit harder for a terrier to follow a cat in the height. A cat is a better jumper, better climber, but still pretadils are known to climb several meters. So also there, this is just another way of buying time. And if things go miss, also if your pretadil and cat are playing very nice together, still please keep it separate when you're leaving, because it could be that the pretadil plays very nice with the cat and the cat plays very nice with the dog when you're around, because they have some respect for you and that keeps them from getting at each other. But maybe when you're gone and the cat will for example keep on running away, triggering the hunting drive, this could be completely different, and then you get home with injured animals. But in my opinion, you can do a lot of things, especially if the cat is more robust, it has a better chance of surviving a longer time. And also if you just keep it separated, there's nothing that normally would happen, because you cannot interact with each other there. That being said, don't be unwise and think, oh, I just have a dog and they get along very nicely. It's just another predator they try to control. And if it all goes right, of course, then you were separating without need. But if it goes wrong, you will be glad that you did. And even a pup can change once matured. Also, cats can change in their interaction. Have a great day.
Today we will discuss the future of brachycephalic dog breeds. So first, what is brachycephalic? So it comes from Greek, which means short and head. So to make it very easy, a short snout, so to say. And examples of thereof will be a French bulldog, pug, boxer, English bulldog, Boston terrier, but also dogs like Lhasa Apso, Pekingese, those guys. And the thing is, in the past they were bred a lot and exaggerated each generation, but nowadays people are waking up and saying, okay, there are so many drawbacks with this that we do not want it anymore. And what could be the drawbacks? This brachycephalic snout comes with breathing problems, also often problems for a space of eyes and sometimes even brains. So that's not something that they like. And if they have breathing problems, of course their athletic ability and their hearts will have a hard time. But other factors are also there. It's very hard to have the pups born in a natural way, oftentimes even impossible, and they use cesarean section to deal with this. Some breeds are even that unathletic that they are not even able to mate in a natural way. Okay, that being said, what is the solution? They now use different breeds with longer snouts to reinvigorate the brachycephalic dog breeds. And what will be the result of that? course, the first result would be for the brachycephalic dogweed to get a little bit of more of a normal snout. So a longer snout like this dog has, introduced to a brachycephalic breed, will give you something in between, of course. But then what they do, normally they breed only one generation, which would be 50% F1, and then they breed till the F2, 25%, the F3, 12.5%, and then F4, 6.25%, and that's often enough to get to the easy rules that they now have for brachycephalic breeds. So those rules were increased in the amount of snout length compared to the skull length in time, but now this would be suitable again. And that's still very little added capability. The other thing is, it's not only the snout length, but the snout length can exist because those dogs were just there for being a companion dog with no functionality or very limited functionality. So also other parts of the dogs will be revigorated by a longer snout length, of course, but also all the other benefits of a more athletic breed. For example, working dog like a Pettadale will really help. So the benefits of the brachycephalic breeds are many. However, sometimes they use blood that has a completely different character. For example, the Pug, they breed in beagle blood to make the Puggle, so to say. And the beagle has a completely different character than the Pug. It would be far wiser to use a dog like a Staffordshire Bull Terrier, or even better, a Pettadale Terrier, because the Pettadale Terrier is work bred and also it's more the size. I would never ever recommend using a good dog, for example Pettadale Terrier, as a bitch to a Pug or something like that, because you would further destroy a good breed. Whereas if you just use it as a sire, the sire can sire a lot of bitches, whereas a bitch can only receive insemination by a limited amount of sires. And that's also bringing me to the next point. Of course, you will improve the handicapped breed, but you can also destroy a healthy breed, a working breed. So therefore, as I mentioned, only use semen, only use sires instead of the other way around. Otherwise you will dilute the working breed and you will be left with nothing, because everything will be more the same, but nothing will be good. And that brings me to the future. Why would you use deformed dogs to start with? They were just pet dogs, they have no functionality left. And for example, if you were looking for bulldogs, for example English bulldogs, you now see the old English bulldog or the leave-it bulldogs, they are all a lot better than the original English bulldog. But then you can also look at those descendants that closest resemble the original working English bulldog, which would be an American Pit Bull Terrier or a working Bull and Terrier. Yeah? For example, Irish Staffordshire Bull Terrier. And that would be a far better starting point, in my opinion. That being said, it is something that people like. And what do they like about the brachycephalic breeds? They have a human-like appearance. And because their face is so flat, it resembles a little bit that of a human. Also, the eyes are often bulging out, which also makes them very big. And to be frankly, also a lot of people like it that a dog doesn't need that much of exercise, but can fly it easily. cannot deal with it, so that they don't have to deal with it. So weak people seek weak dogs, whereas strong people seek strong dogs. That's my opinion. I hope you like this video. If you do, let me know. If you don't, let me know as well. Have a great day. Bye bye. On this windy morning, we're going to talk about the evolution of dogs of war. So tactical dogs, dogs for military purposes. These dogs started out as molosses, but have gradually developed more into the shepherd type of dogs. And I will tell you why, and also what has been changed. So first of all, why were the first dogs of war more of a molosser type? The purpose of these type of dogs were, to say very bluntly, cannon fodder, and also to deal with other animals. So what do I mean in this this context? Dogs were used to combat cavalry, so people that brought their horses and were a pest to the infantry, so the people on foot, because they would have enormous impact, would travel fast, and would just flank and pierce through those infantry troops. And what they did is they used dogs, and they put either fiery pots on their back and sent them in. So then they walked under the horses. The horses feel the flames and would just go on the back legs and throw off the riders. Another option would be that the dogs would carry spikes on their backs or blades with a similar purpose, to cut open the horses from underneath or their legs, and that also would render them unusable. Very often these horses had armor, and the underbelly was often easier to be targeted, as well as the legs. Another thing is that they also use these dogs to have hand-to-hand combat, or dog to infantry, especially combat, and they would just have to fight. So either by attacking those horses, you should have a decent size, but also decent strength to cut them open or carry those fire pots, but also in the context of hand-to-hand combat, you need a strong dog to be a man stopper. So as we discussed, one of the properties would be strong dog, which the molossers are, very strong dogs, but also a very brave dog, because even horses oftentimes did not want to go into combat, and you need a certain type of dog that will go into the fire, blood, screams, and also the big animals and just charge in. And therefore they use this molosser type of dogs, which are next to very big, also very brave, and they were called dogs of war. These are the similar types of dogs also used in combat in, for example, arenas like the Colosseum, and also were there to just deal with humans. And how did they deal with humans? It's a man stopping ability, so they would jump up and throw the human to the ground, and then ground and pound on upon them. A similar way was used against the Indians by the Spanish conquistadores. And derivatives thereof are still being used there. For example, the Villa Brasileiro still carries that blood to a high degree. So big type of molosser, hound type of dog that could sniff them out if needed. This is different than the standard dogs of war, that were not that much of a sniffing dog, just thrown in and normally would not survive. So they would be trampled upon and dealt with as soon as possible, because they were faster than infantry, for example, and they would just charge in and also very often die. Therefore, they did not have the need of enormous amount of interaction between dogs and also human soldiers. So the shepherd type of characteristics were not as much needed in that time. Whereas the modern day Villa Brasileira was also developed out of these dogs of war, but also with more sniffing ability to catch those that were hiding or fleeing, and to also bring them to a halt. That being said, that was the origin of the war dog. Also, there were other roles for war dogs, for example, communication, and then it would be nice to have a smaller type of dog or faster type of dog. But we can skip that. We just stick to the regular type of tactical dogs. And in this day and age, it has evolved from this Molosse type of dog to a herding type of dog. But not an actually herding type of dog. It's descendants of originally herding types of dogs, but they are now more of a tactical, military, police type of dog. So, for example, the German Shepherd dog. But that dog was very popular also in tactical operation, but has now been surpassed completely by two dog breeds. One is Malinois, which is a Belgian herder, but also the Dutch Shepherd, which is a Dutch herder. And especially the smooth-coated varieties are the most used tactical dogs in this day and age. And there's something else going on. Again, they are adding combat genes to make them more dependable, more robust, and also increase their bravery to a high degree. And they do not use normally Molosse type of blood, but they do use Bull and Terrier type of blood. And the Bull and Terrier, you can see as a further evolvement of the Molosse, but in the smaller size, even braver, better combat. Characteristics, but in a far smaller and nimbler body. And these Bull and Terriers are now added to herder blood. Oftentimes denoted as Malinois X or Dutch Shepherd X. Next to some German Shepherd blood, that's also infused, and sometimes some other blood like Rudenbeler, which is also Belgian Shepherd. It's like a darker colored, long haired nephew of the Malinois. And the thing is, if you're breeding for performance, normally you will line breed and interbreed. And very often time you can also inbreed depression. One source of human is to go out or a related type of dog. And then the German Shepherd dog would bring also a bigger stature to deal with the high inbreeding in the past. So the high inbreeding would also lead to smaller dogs, so you need a certain size. But nowadays, more and more you see that the Bull and Terrier blood is introduced. And that those crosses are predominantly herders. So herding breeds like Malinois and Dutch Shepherd, but also carry a degree of Bull and Terrier blood, which can make up to 25% in some performance lines, but are often more diluted. And it should be said that if the modern tactical dogs, especially the Dutch Shepherd, already carried more Bull blood as compared to the Malinois, so a little bit lower to the ground, so lower hated withers and more massive build, also less less frantic, so to say, than the Malinois, which can be quite nervous in the
hands of police, which would lead, and in military hands, which could lead to also attacking their own forces, which of course is not the thing that they want. Otherwise they would opt for a different type of breed. Also the benefit of bull and terrier blood is of course being pure fighting blood. They don't get stressed out, they can deal with the enormous pressure, and they have high courage, high fighting ability, even in a small package. And if they are kept to be small, they can also easier wriggle themselves to small places to attack their opponent. The thing is that next to this normal features, also sometimes now dogs are used for sniffing or patrolling, sniffing for drugs or weapons, also bombs. They lead to big tactical advantages, but also the ability to patrol and have more heightened senses of smell and sight at your disposal is a very good thing, of course. So that brings you to the modern day tactical war dog, which is also used by police forces. Hope you like this video. If you do, feel free to subscribe and like. It helps me a lot. Have a great day. This is a man. Spiking us. Zelf al gevraagd, hè?
Ik heb er een geschild.
Oh jee. Hé, hey, ik krijg met jou in de stok. En los. Los. Dat is flink. Dat is een flinke jongen, hè? Lekker stokje, hè? Kijk hier, los. Wachten. Oh.
Nee. Dat is goed. Hé hey jongen, wacht even. De licht. De lichtbalans, hè? Slagen. Stop. Goed zo.
Today we are going to talk about Turkish great livestock protection breeds, and there's one country that has five enormously strong and big livestock protection breeds. First, start with the one that most people don't know. This is the Karadani mountain dog. This is a dog that's different to all the others, with an extremely thick coat and a very strong build as well, without being too much of a mastiff type. So you get a dog with the resemblance of a Central Asian Ovcharka in big parts. Then you have a dog that's far closer to a mastiff type, the most mastiff and most molosser type of dog, with saggy lips and also extremely big bone structure. This is the Malakli. This dog is different to all the other breeds except the Bos Shepherd, also that it has a short coat, a very short coat. This is a real strong dog type, especially very strong for its size. Not the strongest, and it will tell you a lot. The strongest is then the Bos Shepherd. Also, shorter hair, a little bit longer than the Malakli, but not as massive in build, but it is extremely massive in size. It's one of the biggest dogs in the world, and if you look at the size, the average size of the specimens, they might be the biggest dogs there are, so even bigger than Great Dane and Irish Wolfhound. And all these breeds are, of course, livestock protection breeds, but this is a dog that can even dwarf an extremely big wild canine, such as the, Alaskan wolf. The Bos Shepherd is also different to, for example, the most known, the Kangal. It's the most known Turkish breed. This is already a very big, massive dog, but has longer hair and also slightly different build. And it's not smaller, but even a Kangal is very capable of dealing with wolves, you might say. So how can it that the Bos Shepherd dwarfs them and the Kangal doesn't? Kangal dwarfs local Turkish wolves, perhaps, but those local Turkish wolves are a lot smaller than those wolves found in Alaska. That's the reason. So an Alaskan wolf can weigh up to 60 kilograms, whereas a Turkish wolf, I think, would be on average between 30 and 40. So it's almost half the weight, and it also has an effect on the size, of course. But the Kangal is very known and brings you the benefits of a massive type of weight in a more of a shepherd type of body, so less massive and very good and agile. There's also the last breed, the fifth breed, which is the Ekbas, which looks a lot like the Kangal, but this Ekbas means whitehead. You could see it a little bit like a subspecies, but they are different altogether. And FCE registration, I think they were both registered as one breed, also known as Anatolian Shepherd. But this
according to Turkish shepherds, is Rome. So now we had one country and five livestock protection breeds. How can this be? All those breeds appeal to different different needs, especially the Akwas and the Kengo are a lot alike, but all those others are vastly different as well. And the livestock protection breeds can be seen as a land race. So what that means is, depending on the land they were used on and the specifics that come with it, they've developed a certain little bit different type. So also, for example, the Ovčarka that I mentioned is very close to some of the Turkish breeds, and whereas, for example, the Alabai would also be close to some others. If you, for example, would cross Akbas and Malakli type of Turkish breed, you would be close to an Alabai. It's not the same. I'm not saying that it is the same, but that's the reason. The Dokie on the Leash is my Patterdale Terrier, not a livestock protection breed in that sense of the word. It is used to protect livestock, especially poultry and sheep, lambs, against foxes and badgers, by going into the foxes and badgers dens, or fells as they call them. Therefore, they're also known as fell terrier. And the fell is like a rocky den, and deal with the predator there. Have a great day. Today we are going to talk about the Akbaş. This is a dog from Turkey, from the region Eskişehir here, which is main a steppe region. Turkey has five livestock guardian breeds. I'll put a link in the description, or I will put a video about those five at the end of this video. So if you are interested, please also look at that. The Akbaş is a dog which is translated into white heads. So they are mainly white, and they look quite a bit like the most known livestock guardian of Turkey, being the Kengo, but they are slightly smaller, and their character and behavior is also slightly different. So this is still a dog that has many of the characteristics that you also find in the Kengo breed. So not the massive traits that the Malaki Turkish breed has. It's a big dog still, males between 65 and 85 centimeters at the withers, can be over 60 kilograms in weight. So albeit being a bit smaller than a Kengo, this is still a massive, strong type of dog. Also, on average, males will be between 75 and 82 centimeters at the width. So this is a dog very capable of protecting livestock and also protecting families. It has man-stopping ability. That being said, it is a dog that is still quite agile. It has the build that sits between a molosser and a shepherd, but leans a lot to the direction of a shepherd, but still retains a massive and strong head. So in other words, you get a big dog that's still being agile, and in that way you get a lot of the best of both worlds. Also, in the performance shepherd lines, you see that they use bull blood, and you could see this as a mastiff shepherd type of dog. So in the performance this helps. It's also a very brave dog. It will even defend livestock against wolves, and oftentimes they are able to overpower wolves, even one-on-one. But it should be said that the wolves in Turkey are a bit smaller than the biggest wolves that live more on the northern regions, for example Alaska. And those wolves, those Alaskan wolves, can reach up to 60 kilograms or a little bit over, whereas the wolves in Turkey are normally around 40-ish kilograms, sometimes smaller, even 30. So please keep this in mind. Also, if you live close to the Alaskan border, the coat is not that extremely thick. There are livestock protection breeds with thicker coats, which can also help. That being said, also the Akbash has a nice coat, not too long, but also not too short, giving good isolation properties, but also good heat management, so that they can dispense the heat and do it overheat easily. This is a type of dog that's not for a first-time owner. In general, it's a good dog to give a purpose, especially if you get it from purpose lines. The FCE sometimes throws the Akbash and the Kangol on one big heap, which is not correct according to the Turkish people. But there should be also some thing to say about that in the other direction, and that is that these livestock protection breeds are a land race, so to say, and that means that you just have local varieties of the same stuff, and thereby they are quite related. So all in all, you just have to make your own opinion. For me personally, the coat would not be the determining factor, so this would not be the main selling point for me. But I can imagine there is some reasoning about a white coat, or almost white coat, like the Akbash has. Also, for example, Dogo Argentino has this highly reflective properties, which can be beneficial if you are living somewhere where you have warm days at a steppe where they come from, or even a desert environment, but cold nights, and the Akbash has a good coat to cope with the cold, but also with the heat. And also, for example, Dogo Argentino has his white coat to deal with the heat in Argentina when they hunt pigs. So, that being said, I hope you like this video. Please look in the link or continue watching this video to see also the other five livestock guardian breeds of Turkey. Have a great day. Today we are going to discuss the most known livestock protector of Turkey, which is the Kangol. I say most known because there are five livestock protection breeds in Turkey, which I will put a link in the description, or at the end of the video I will briefly discuss them all so you have an overview. So back to the Kangol. This is one of the biggest livestock protection breeds. It's not the biggest, but still males average between 70 to 90 centimeters at the withers. That's the total range. At the average, they would be 75 to 82, 83 centimeters at the withers, which makes them quite a big dog. They can weigh easily over 60 kilograms, but because they are that big, they are still very agile. It's a very good livestock protection breed if you want an active dog. They are much more active than, for example, Pyrenean mountain dogs. Also, the coat is sufficient to protect them against the elements if it's not too cold, but also allows them to dispense the heat, which is a good thing in my opinion. They come in a broad variety of colors, but very often this is more of a sandy color type of dog, also often with a darker mask. This is opposite to the Akbash, which is a variety that is called white head, and those coats are often lighter. Also, the Akbash is slightly bit smaller. The benefit of a Kangol type of dog is for a farmer
that it protects the livestock against predators, for example bears, but especially wolves. And Kangals are known to easily overpower local wolves. And that's part due to their size. Yeah, they are massive, and also the wolves in Turkey are slightly smaller than the biggest wolf breeds. So in Turkey average 30 to 40 kilograms, and in the Alaskan regions they can grow up to 60 kilograms or above. That's the difference. Also the Kangal looks a little bit like a wolf, but more powerful, slanted eyes. The connection between nose and head is almost flat. They don't have saggy lips like a mastiff, so you have a nice closed mouth, which I like, instead of those drooling monsters that you sometimes see, which can also be nice, but I do not like that much. Also for living indoors, if a drooling dog just shakes his head, you will have saliva all over the place. And also if it has drunk water, you can imagine the effect. So back to the Kangal. This dog offers you speed and power and intimidation. So also very often wolves will just stay away from livestock that's protected by Kangals. Very often it's more than one. 2 to 3 is a normal amount. This is also a good thing because wolves hunter packs. Also Kangals normally when they are on duty have big collars, a lot bigger than that, but also laced with spikes. So if a wolf attacks them, it will also bite that spiked collar, which of course will damage the wolf itself instead of giving him the advantage. For example, threading the throat of its opponent. This type of dog is big enough, easily big enough to deal also with human attackers. So it has full man-stopping ability. It can throw a man to the ground and also keep it there because of its size, strength and weight. It is easily a bigger, stronger dog than your average Rottweiler, which is already fairly capable of doing so. So it gives you a little bit of perspective. These dogs need a purpose instead of just being a pet. And you should also take good care because they are very vigilant and you do not want them to attack those that have friendly intentions. Also with other dogs they tend to go quite well, but all these livestock protection breeds are alpha breeds, so they want to be the boss. And if you have an other alpha or dominant type of dog, it will probably end in a fight, especially if they are the same sex. So please keep this in mind. And the type of dog that a Kangal is, being massively big, massively strong, of working origin, and even capable of killing wolves, you can imagine what it will do with another dog. So please keep this in mind. It's not a dog for every situation. Especially it's a good dog if you are a farmer and the wolf is now reintroduced and you're suffering, because this dog will keep the flock safe and also can double up as a guard dog and family companion. But on the other hand, if you have a lot of other people coming in and out, this might not be the dog for you because it's that vigilant. And also it takes a lot of energy for you to keep it leased every time when someone is around, so that it doesn't get into problems. So, hope you like this video. I will put a link in the description about the other 5 Turkish livestock protection breeds. And Turkey has a big amount of these breeds and also a rich tradition. And so please feel free to click on that link or just follow this video. If it continues, then I have put the video behind this one. Have a great day.
Today we will discuss the Turkish breed known as Somalakli. This is one of the 5 livestock protection breeds that they have in Turkey, but this is a little bit different than all other 4, being that it's more of a protector breed in general. So not only livestock, just part of the protection, not such a specialist, but it's just a protection specialist. Also houses and tents. This is more of a warrior type of dog. It's also the biggest in weight of those 5. There's more of a massive build, so also a shorter fur, a shorter nose with massive jaws, and also a thinner tail to accompany it. So in this case you could see it more as a Burgu type of dog, but a little bit more athletic, so more on the legs. Also these dogs can be huge. They are normally between 80 and 100 centimeters to width, which is enormous. Just enormous. And this is a Great Dane territory. That gives you some insight, but it's a lot more massive dog. Malakli means with lips in Turkish. So these dogs also carry the droopy lips. I'm not a big fan of that, but it oftentimes comes with those massive builds. Also the Boer Bull, for example, or another massive dog, the Bordeaux, they all carry this droopy lips. It's a enormously strong protecting type of dog. Man-stopping ability would just be easy breezy task for the dog this size and weight, and with enormous muscles, very thick bones. It's almost built like a tank, but still quite capable of moving around, which is a big plus. If you have livestock protection purposes, this might be overkill, because the quarry that they face or the predators that they face would normally be also easily overpowered with the Kangal or Ekbash, which are smaller derivatives also found in livestock protection breeds of Turkey. But this is more of a protector, a war type of dog. So if people come in and try to kidnap and they have ill intentions, this is a more of a Boer bulldog to face off with. And just offer as big and mighty protection as possible within one dog. The Malakli is still more working mastiff, which is a big plus. This also gives them, on average, better health, strength, endurance, and also longevity. So these dogs, despite their huge size, would on average, for example, live longer than a Great Dane, which is a big plus. Of course, when they are working, they will not live as long, because they will have a harsher environment to live in, and also they serve the role of protection breeds in dire situations. This also means that they can and will probably suffer enough damage, and also serious type of damage that could be fatal or otherwise limiting their life in one way or another. This Malakli type of Turkish breed is not much known, but is a formidable big protection breed, which can serve as livestock protection, but is more of a molosser, mastiff, house, property and family protector, with also shorter coat, so it doesn't have that much insulation, but has a good way of dispensing heat, and also is easy to be kept inside without shedding too much fur. Hope you like this video. If you do, please leave a like and subscribe. Also, I will put a link in the description, or follow this video up with the other 5 Turkish livestock breeds. Have a great day. Today we are going to discuss the Karadeni mountain dog. This is a Turkish livestock protection breed and is found in a region close to the Black Sea. As the name implies, it's especially found in the mountainous regions and is also known as the shepherd dog. So not only the mountain dog, but also the shepherd dog. This breed can be compared to the livestock protection breeds that we also find in, for example, Russia. It looks like a smaller Ovcharka, Central Asian Ovcharka. Also a little bit less bulky built. That being said, has a good stop. Still decent size, even big for many of people, because the males can weigh up to 70 kilograms and can have a head of the withers up to 90 centimeters of height. So this places them as very big dogs indeed, but not the biggest Turkish breeds. Compared to the, other Turkish breeds, for example Kongo or Akbaş or even the Malakli and Bos, they have enormously big coats, so very long-haired animals, which protects them against cold, but also that region is very much exposed to rains, so the coat is also very good at protecting against hypothermia when rain would normally cause the body to cool down to a high degree. This furry coat also has a good weather protection, especially against rain and cold climates. This type of dog can also be compared to other livestock protection breeds, such as Pyrenean mountain dog. It's a little bit different in color. Normally this Turkish breed is more of a black, gray and a darker color, whereas the Pyrenean mountain dog is more of a lighter color type of dog. I hope you like this short video. And if you do, feel free to subscribe. That helps me a lot. Have a great day. Today we will discuss the Bos Shepherd, B-O-Z. And this is the biggest Turkish breed and even one of the biggest breeds in general. Whereas males can be over 100 centimeters at the withers, but very often between 85 and 95 centimeters at the withers. It's an enormous dog, even dwarfs big dogs such as a Kango. It also, compared to the Kango, has a more stop to the face, not as massive as the Malakli, another Turkish breed. But since in build a little bit between Malakli and Kango, the coat is also a lot shorter than Kango, and not as short as the Malakli, but still very short. I think it would be one-third Malakli or one-fourth Malakli and the rest Kango in looks, but the size is a lot bigger than both the Malakli and the Kango. The weight of the Malakli could be a little bit bigger or higher, but the height and the length of the Bos Shepherd is the biggest of all. And this type of dog is found in the southern regions close to mountainous areas. It is an exceptionally big and strong dog. Its coat is a little bit less thick than that of Kango, and not as short as that of the Malakli, but gives you very good protection against elements that are not too extreme, but also very good heat dispension, so that they don't overheat. Especially for a big dog, this is a good thing to have. Also easy to clean, and will not easily get extremely dirty. This is an enormously big dog, also very aggressive, with a very strong musculature
musculature body, even stronger than that of a Kango, also for the same size. Very massive head. This is a dog that could easily destroy even a big wolf, especially if they have the thick collar. This is also a thick collar on my Patterdale, but those have thick collars and even thicker, and then spiked. So if a wolf attacks, it will get hurt. The wolves in the Turkish region are a lot smaller than those in the northern countries, especially Alaska, but still big and also fighting packs. The Bos Shepherd is really the Bos, so the B-O-Z is also the B-O-S-S. It's an enormous dog, very intimidating. It has in the intimidation almost the impression that a Bully Kuta could give you, which is of an enormous and very strong dog. Bully Kuta, in my opinion, looks a lot more intimidating because it has more saggy lips, and also you see the muscles easier. But the Bos Shepherd has a little bit more coat and is extremely capable. I think as a dog to have, I would rather have a Bos Shepherd than a Bully Kuta, because it sits a little bit more on the normal side, and I don't like drooling dogs. And Bos Shepherd has more lips, especially as compared to, for example, a Kango, but it's not as lippy as, for example, an Alabai or another Turkish breed. The breed we know as the Malakli, which is more of a mastiff type of breed. So very nice balance, but very strong dog. Makes the Bos Shepherd one of the best wolf killing ability type of animals. It also has the affinity to protect livestock. Well, I hope you like this video. If you do, please like, comment, and subscribe if you like to. Have a great day. Hey, zachtjes, zachtjes. Just nipped me a little bit on the finger. Because his tooth slid off the ball.